Well, I was wrong. I went for Cisco to win, and Spartak have pulled it off. You know, it was a very, very broken game the last 20 minutes or so. Just loads of wide open chances for both sides, to be fair. But you've got to give Spartak credit. They came to the Lions then, and they held their nerve. They picked the right team, in my view. Massimo Carrera did not pick Ilya Kutepov again. I just don't rate the guy. I'm sorry. I know some people say he's talented. He wouldn't have stood up to this game. But they were... Pardon me, there's so much smoke in the stands. The Cisco fans let off firebomb after smoke bomb after flare. I mean, I don't know how much you can tell down there. You can see the ashes. They were burning flags, burning banners. That was just... I mean, that was a derby, all right. But Cisco, they just... they didn't hold their nerve like I thought they would. So, Gluzhkov with the winner from an absolutely horrendous mistake from Viktor Vasin. You'll never see anything more boneheaded in your life. The Akinfeev made a save. Vasin cleared up and then started dribbling along the byline when he had four chances to clear it. Tackled, Gluzhkov taps it in. Final, just for the final whistle. Ball went out of play. And I couldn't quite see, but it looked like a Spartak player from their bench kicked it onto the pitch. Vibras Makro kicked it away straight at the bench. Bit of a hoo-ha. And then final whistle went. Massimo Carrera, quite understandably, went absolutely berserk in celebration. Well, that is it. That is officially it. For once and for all, we can finally say that is Spartak champions. First time in 16 years. I mean, mathematically it's not, but realistically it is. Well, you've got to say, they've been the best team all season. The table doesn't lie. I mean, it's a cliche, but cliche for a reason. Goncharenko, well, he's still got age on his side. He's got time on his side. He is a great tactical coach, and his time will come. But I'm afraid today he was outwitted by Carrera. He sent on Fyodor Chalov with about a minute or two of injury time to go. Olinair was a good substitution. Yeah, I don't know how much you can hear me because there's so much noise. I'm going to lose my voice in a minute. And that is one thing you can say about the Cisco fans. They did not shut up all game. Olinair was very, very dangerous when he came on. Alexei Ionov, he was a game player, but he didn't add anything to his side. As far as I'm concerned, it's not all season, really. Olinair should be playing. But too little, too late. So that Cisco season pretty much over. Now the question remains is, can they hold on to Champions League spot? Zenit, I'll be honest, off the top of my head, I've lost track of when they're playing. Whether they've already played today or are playing later. But that's a golden opportunity for them. They will surely go 2 points clear in the race for Champions League. That is a massive, massive hammer blow. Being beaten by your rivals in your home stadium is never palatable, but this is about the least palatable situation of all. Other than the football, there were some brief racist chantings and monkey chants towards Quincy Promise, who broke away in one of those fractious breakaways I mentioned. He was through on goal, well, more or less through on goal, very quick, outpacing the defence. Hit the post smack on, and there was some brief monkey chants for a while. But really, the pyrotechnics, they had to stop the game on three occasions. Another bang, you can hear that. How the hell they get these pyrotechnics into the ground, I will never know. I mean, coming into the ground, it was about up to about 1,000 people at a conservative estimate, all being funneled into one ramp in the end I was coming into. So you're like sardines, and there were a whole cordon of police linked arms to stop people jumping the queue. There's one checkpoint, they pat you down briefly, another checkpoint, they pat you down, and eventually you get in. And they just come in with endless supplies of these smoke bombs and pyro. I mean, some people are for it in a controlled manner, and I can see the value of how it adds to the aesthetic occasion. But in truth, it is just, it's just inconceivable how that is allowed to happen under UEFA guidelines. Now, I mean, I'm sticking around a bit because I'm in no desperate rush to get home. I've got a flight to catch in the morning to Sochi for the Russian Cup final. But you're looking around, Siska's main stand, they're not moving for some time. The far stand, most people are still there, and Spartak fans, understandably, are going to enjoy the moment. I guess they will also be required to step behind because they won't let, obviously, all sets of fans out at the same time. So that's it. I may do one brief video recap later, but I mean, that's about it for me from the VEB Arena. The stadium itself, top marks, absolutely magnificent stadium, beautiful stadium, acoustically fantastic. I mean, the sound just reverberates. I don't know how much you can tell from here, but the angle, just look at the seats behind me, there's no overlap from the top of one seat to the bottom of the next. Such steep gradients to the stands, it makes for just brilliant view. Everybody has perfect view. Right now, I mean, I'm just putting it flat across. You can see I am right at one end. Normally, most stadium, that would mean you get a pretty rubbish view, but brilliant view, absolutely fantastic view. So stadium gets top marks and always will for me. I've been here in a quiet game with only about a third full, a quarter full against Ordal. Incredible atmosphere. And actually packed out stadium today. So understandably, the atmosphere was also brilliant. Noise was incredible. The security was very good too. We've got to give them credit. Right from 2.5 hours before kickoff, when I got off the metro, there were about 30 armed police, I counted. Obviously, I didn't take a picture or a video of them. But there were 30 armed police at the main metro stop. And they say, Spartak this way, Tiskar the other. 2.5 hours before the game. Outside the ground, I don't guess how many. This would be very hard to judge. A significant presence. Right in this corner, I mean, I'm right in the corner here. That's the very end of the pitch, right? Technically, this was designated a neutral zone. There were about 10 to 15 Spartak fans just in this row alone. Well, I'd say in this 200-300 seats. There were a few angry words said, but no more than angry words and handbags. Within seconds, police were in, splitting it up, dispersing them. It was very effective, and I wouldn't in any way say overhanded, heavy-handed policing at all. It was very effective. People know not to mess when they're around. Now, I mean, in terms of the Tiska home fans and the pyro that they managed to get their hands on, I don't know what more can be done. I mean, how they got them past security, I don't know, but once they're in, there's not a lot that can be done. There were no visible flashpoints. Spartak fans, they did set alight a few banners early on, let off some flash bombs, smoke bombs. The noise is incredible. Just look at this. This is like 15 minutes after they've just been, well, in the end, as it turned out, outfought and outplayed by their rivals in the home game in their derby, and they're still making this noise. Unbelievable. So, Tiska fans, the atmosphere, top marks as well. And Spartak, so you've got to give them credit. I mean, it's always going to be like that in the home derby. I'm taking the nets down and I'm being ushered out as we speak. Guy over my shoulder there, you can see he's sitting down. He's pretty despondent again, understandably. The one area of the stadium I would not give top marks to is how they get fans into the stadium. It's an absolute mess. It was just crammed into a bottleneck, which is the one thing you avoid in stadium management. Just listen to this. I don't understand the words. If you speak Russian, maybe you can translate. I can't understand a word of it, but it's bloody noisy, that's all I will say. But you know, back to getting fans into the ground, the bottleneck they created was, I was very lucky to get in to before the scheduled kickoff, and I left 45 minutes beforehand. I'm going to start walking out because it really is time to leave. So overall, if you are thinking of coming to Moscow for the Moscow derby, I can't speak highly enough of it. I paid for a mid-range ticket and I paid 2,500 rubles. So in modern day, that's about 30 quid. Bearing in mind, you pay £50 plus for English Premier League football. I would say that is an absolute bargain. And like I say, the view, the atmosphere, pretty much any sector of the stadium for this fixture is unbeatable. You can't argue with it. The fans are non-stop. If you're worried about the pyro and a bit of extra noise and aggro, then just don't sit in the Tisca Ultra section. But even if you want to sit in there, you've got to go from checks. They run their own interview with people who want to get tickets there. They even ban people who have travelled to the Caucasus, apparently. That's what I've been told. I don't know how strictly they can police that for the whole stand, but anyway, atmosphere unbeatable. The football, it was very open, very interesting, very exciting game. It didn't pan out how I expected, but quick shout out to my editor at Football Ground, Manuel Veth. He did indeed say that it would be key for Grushkov and Zeluish coming back, and they were the goal scorers. And they proved to be the difference. I mean, he won't grab the headlines, but for me, Fernando in midfield for Spartak all season, for me, he's been one of the standout players of this season, and he'll go unheralded. He's brought in for, I believe it was 11 million from Sampdoria. Nobody had really heard much about him. He has been an absolute lot. Him and Grushkov in the midfield are just, I'd say, the best centre midfield partnership in the Russian Premier League. So, yep, it's a very different atmosphere outside to when I came in. Bit of merchandise still going on there, but not going to have many takers in this mood. Fans filing out, and yeah, what can I say? It is one of the must-see games. It's a bucket list game. This particular fixture, it didn't go how I expected. I expected Tisca to really rise to the occasion, especially with Alan Zagoev, who overcame his injury unexpectedly, but he didn't have much effect on the game, not as much as he should have. Alexander Golovin, one of the bright young hopes of Russian football, he was in the thick of most of the chances for Tisca, and indeed after 1 minute he hit the post from a ridiculously tight angle. We couldn't really be blamed for that. I mean, Moscow the city, well, I mean, that's just too large for me to cover it, but if I was going to sum it up, I'd say it will pleasantly surprise you. It is a beautiful city in many areas. I was looking around at bars around the area, little cafes, and I stumbled across one building and I asked this Armenian restaurant owner what it was, and he said it was the, I forget the exact name, the Palace Tower, something like that. Loads of celebrities live in that, famous people and businessmen. And I'm just strolling down now. I'll show you probably in a separate video because I'm about to run out, running up to 15 minutes. Lots of green space and parks right in the very centre in one of the main train stations, which if you come to Moscow, you will come to if you go to Domodedovo Airport. There's a beautiful embankment by the river, British Embassy on the far bank. And, you know, I mean, what can I say? There are unsavoury elements. You tell me one society in the world that doesn't. And the people here, they will welcome you. You fuck around with them, they'll fuck around with you. But then, again, like I say, that happened anywhere. That's not a specifically Russian thing. That's just simply human nature. And they are very welcoming people. And they are desperate to put on a good show. And by that I mean they will do what it takes to make sure it runs smoothly. In terms of visas and getting entrance to the country, if you have match tickets and you have a fan ID, you go through the proper channels, you won't have any problems. And there is just, the size of the country, there's so much to see. And I've actually been told today that transport between cities during the World Cup is going to be free. The transport around Moscow is going to be free. The metro system, in my opinion, is the best metro system in the world. I paid 200 rubles, which is £3, for a one-day unlimited ticket, and that's for all transport, public transport in the whole city. There's a brand new circle line which links the Luzhniki Stadium to, well, almost to CSKA Stadium, but it's only about 500-600 metres away. There's going to be an even closer station built in. Transport is magnificent. What can I say? I'm biased because I live here, but Christ, you've got to come. Do not believe the propaganda press. come and enjoy it. It's going to be an incredible World Cup. Guys, that's me over and out. I'll see you soon.